Hey everyone, this is Turd Flinging Monkey. So I'm seeing a new kind of argument emerging from anti-MGTOWs. And this doesn't obviously apply to all MGTOWs, this applies more to me specifically because I talk about patriarchy, taking away women's rights, and that sort of thing. And their argument goes that taking away women's rights, advocating for patriarchy, is against the concept of Western civilization. Western civilization itself, the values of Western civilization are all about equality, and egalitarianism, and equal rights. And so if you're talking about taking away women's rights or scaling back the rights of women and reinstituting a patriarchy, you're actually betraying Western civilization itself. In order to preserve Western civilization, you need to advocate for egalitarianism and at least first and second wave feminism. It's okay to be against third wave feminism, but first and second wave feminism are great and you should be in support of them. And so on and so on. That's generally the argument I'm hearing. Western civilization is on my side, and I'll prove it. I will prove it right now in this video. Western civilization goes back about 2,500 years, all the way back to ancient Greece. I'm going to post a whole bunch of sources in the description. Go ahead and click the links if you want to read these. I'm going to be reading a lot of quotes, so I apologize. Anyway, according to my first source, the three pillars of Western civilization are the Greek and Roman legacy, Christianity, specifically the medieval Catholic Church, and the customs of the Germanic barbarians. So to begin, let's look at the Greek and Roman legacy, starting with Greece. According to my sources, gender roles in ancient Greece were extremely different back then. Women and men had their respective roles in their societies. Women were supposed to have kids and stay home and take care of the family and the household. Everywhere they went, they were accompanied by men, because if they weren't, the women were seen as a lower, less respected class. Women didn't have any rights, the man had all the power over them. In fact, this system is called a patriarchy, when the father of the oldest male figure is the head of the household. Women were not even allowed to eat and sleep in the same room with men. Rich women often had to take care of their slaves as well as their own children and their household chores. Men's role in society was to keep the family stable, both financially and in general. For example, he had to teach his wife how to properly take care of the household so she could keep the house in order when he wasn't around. Men usually worked as farmers or businessmen or as high officials. At the young age, men were educated and trained for their future careers, while girls stayed home with their mothers and learned how to cook and clean. Patriarchy and misogyny go together, for they both show that subordination and dominance towards women. Women in ancient Greece were regarded with contempt, secluded, and uneducated. These were the ways in which men and women were supposed to act and behave according to society at the time. End quote. Well, so much for Greece, let's move on to Rome. According to my sources, quote, in many cases, Roman women were closely identified with their perceived role in society, the duty of looking after the home and to nurture a family, in particular, to bear legitimate children, a consequence of which was an early marriage, sometimes even before puberty, but typically around 20 years old, in order to ensure that the woman had no sexual history which might embarrass the future husband. The Roman family was male-dominated, typically headed by the most senior male figure. Women were subordinate, and this is reflected in Roman naming practices. Male citizens had three names, whilst all women in the same family were referred to using the feminine version of the family name. A married woman could keep her maiden name or be referred to using her husband's name. Within the family, women would attend to the home and its slave workforce, work on handicrafts, and upper-class females might also study academic subjects such as literature and philosophy. This close dependence of women on their male relatives was reflected in such matters as law and finance, where women were legally obliged to have a nominated male family member act in their interests. The only exceptions to this arrangement were women with three children, freed women with four children, and vestal virgins. The rules were designed to keep property, especially inherited property, in the male-controlled family, even if male and female offspring had equal inheritance under Roman law. Another even more chauvinistic explanation of this rule, which allowed women to inherit and own but not control property, was that they were thought incapable of managing such affairs for themselves. This view that women had weak judgment was expounded by Cicero. For example, Roman law did at least stipulate that a wife's property be kept separate from her husband's, except the dowry. and it could be reclaimed following a divorce. Separation by divorce was easily achieved by both parties under Roman law, but any children of the couple legally belonged to the father or nearest male relative if he was no longer living. In the later empire, and especially following legislation imposed by Constantine, divorce became much more difficult, especially for the female party, end quote. Okay, so the Greek and Roman pillar squarely fall in my camp, but let's move on to pillar number two, Christianity, specifically the medieval Catholic Church. My sources read, quote, "The medieval church generally saw women as inherently weaker than men. As the philosopher Philo taught, the male was superior to the woman because he represented the more rational parts of the soul, while the female represented the less rational. Thus, though both men and women experienced lust, it was the woman who was generally unable to control themselves. In their weakness, they led men into sin, harming not only their own salvation, but that of the male society as well." Augustine expanded on this belief by arguing that women not only tempted men into sin, they were the sole cause of male lust. As Bittel described it in Augustine's Real World, men got erections because women inspired them. Women were not evilly sexual beings themselves, but weak extensions of the male body. As extensions of the male body, women were not fully human. This made them weaker and less capable of resisting their sexual urges, therefore leaving them more prone to acts of sexual sin. As women gave in to their urges, they became temptresses. Too weak to control their sexuality, they flaunted it. Their lack of control made it more difficult to men to remain chaste and pious, surrounded as they were by weak, sinful women. In their weakness, women put both themselves and the male population at risk of sin. Thus, if women were too weak to control their urges, it was the responsibility of the inherently stronger man to refuse their advances and help them stay on the path of chastity. Only through total celibacy, excluding acts of procreation while married, could women hope to achieve a superior state of rationality and be elevated to the level of a man. It was also during this time that Aristotelian biology became generally accepted. This theory argued that man is fertile and perfectly formed and contributes soul to the offspring, whereas woman is infertile and deformed and contributes body to the offspring. In other words, women provided children with the physical aspect of life, while men provided the spiritual aspect. This widespread belief seems to argue that something is intrinsically wrong with women, calling them deformed and a defective man. Further, it argues that women's role in reproduction are limited to the physical, which the church argued was ultimately insignificant in the grand scheme of life, and should be carefully controlled and restricted to prevent its coming in between the worshiper and the Lord. Men, however, provided the incredibly important soul to the child. The theory thus implies that women are less connected with spirituality and religion than men. Aristotelian biology once again suggested that women are naturally more sinful due to their weakened connection. However, it also added the concept that women should be submissive and subordinate to the superior gender due to their innate inferiority. Ultimately, all of these arguments trace back to one immortalized woman, Eve. Eve was the first sinner, eating the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good or evil and extending that sin to Adam. Eve was also the first woman, and as a result, many in the medieval church saw all women as descendants of Eve, carrying with them the stain of her sin. Tertullian writes, "Do you not know that you are all each an Eve? You are the devil's gateway. You are the first deserter of the divine law. On account of your desert, that is death, even the Son of God had to die." Eve, as a woman, was weak and unable to resist temptation in the eyes of the church. She was responsible for mankind's fall. She tempted Adam into sin and disobeyed God. For this, she and all womankind as descendants of Eve were punished collectively with the pain of childbirth. Women's punishment for Eve's act thus tied them to her act of sin, making them carry the guilt of her sin and the same tendency towards sin that Eve possessed. Thus, the view of women as the weaker sex is ultimately derived from Eve. Eve was created from one of Adam's ribs. As such, she was again an extension of man and not her own person, derived from just one small piece of a man. Her origin also implied that she had an obligation to be subservient and obedient to man. Eve and all women owe their existence both to God and to Adam for providing the rib from which they were created. The way for them to repay this debt seemed to be obedience and subservience to the man in their lives, to make up for the loss they caused. And for the connection between sexuality and woman, this can be described in the fall. As Augustine describes, lust arose only after mankind's fall. If Eve caused the fall, this meant that sexual sin too was caused by her, and was therefore among the sins all women carried guilt for. As Tertullian wrote, women were just as guilty of original sin as Eve, and were therefore just as guilty of creating sexual sin as Eve. Only through celibacy could this inherited sin be lessened. This portrayal of women as susceptible to sin, inherently flawed, and in need of men's assistance against the weak powers of their bodies, is what limited the power and position of women could achieve in medieval society. The medieval church presented an image of women as incapable of governing. How could a woman lead society if she struggled just to control her own sexuality? She couldn't. As previously explained, medieval society believed that it was more difficult for women to control their lust. Thus, it was sensible for a man to lead her along the path of celibacy. This made women spiritually dependent on men. In turn, this led to the expectation that women would be obedient and submissive to a man guiding them, accepting everything they were told. This portrayed them as second-class citizens, servants to the man in charge of them. With this class position came a lack of power or influence. Authority commands strength, which the medieval church asserted women lacked, unquote. Well, that's 2 out of 3 in my camp, but let's look at the third pillar, the customs of the Germanic barbarians. Now, this one is interesting because there are famous women, queens and warriors who are women in these barbarian mythologies and poems. So first, let me quote this article that was written by a feminist about the Germanic customs and history and so forth. It reads, quote, "Old Norse literature exhibits a society with only one gender constructed around the norms for masculine behavior. Gaining entry into this category through position of family and wealth, individuals needed to display physical and mental strength and to demonstrate ability to defend their honor throughout life. Most able-bodied men belong to this category, but they could lose their status through old age or through accusations of effeminacy. Identified by adjectives that normally describe powerful men, a few women, mainly wealthy widows, or women known for their aggressive dispositions, likewise gain access to this privileged category. Although Clover earlier had contributed to aspects of an alleged female culture, her recent article corroborates Kress's other conclusion, the absorption of female culture within the male hegemony. Clearly, it must be seen as the ultimate victory of a patriarchy when a society does not acknowledge behavior specific to female roles, but only notices a few women able to perform according to male standards, and conversely scorns men who engage in female conduct. The attempt to demonstrate a historical stage of female hegemony in the Old Norse world is no more convincing there than elsewhere. Clover is correct in identifying power as the most admired and powerlessness as the most feared feature in Old Norse society. Because male leaders continue to be concerned with the very existence of their society, and since its survival was best assured by their own skills, they developed a human ideal personified by those they judge best among themselves, ignoring the efforts of half the human population in the necessary task of reproduction and production. Men could afford to admire only these women who conformed to male standards." And here's a quote I just want to read from someone on a message board. I just think it really captures this whole misconception about these warrior women and queens in these Germanic barbarian tribes. It reads, quote, "I am not aware of a single historical account of a Germanic or Celtic woman bearing arms in a routine way. There are mythological accounts of this, most notably the Irish Táin Bó, not sure how to pronounce that, which feature several female warrior figures. The Táin purports to narrate events from the Roman era, but was written down centuries later. The manuscript is from the 9th or 10th century, if I remember right. They may have some warrior goddesses, but so did the Greeks and Romans. Athena, Minerva, anyone? That does not translate into real Amazon warriors or even empowerment for women in any sense. Again, you sometimes do find exceptional female war leaders like Bidouca, who always gets trotted out as a sample of alleged Celtic feminism. But Bidouca is the exception that proves the rule. The Iceni had been ruled by her husband, who willed his kingdom jointly to their daughters and the Romans. When the Romans ignored her daughter's claim and took over, she led an Iceni uprising. This episode shows that the Celts may have been more willing to accept female rule than Romans, but that is hardly normal. 9 times out of 10, when the Romans dealt with barbarian tribes, they found them led by kings, not queens, leading armies of men. One should also point out that in exceptional circumstances, you also find female leadership in the classic Mediterranean as well. Artemisia, for instance, led her people in Xerxes' army during the Persian War. There are always extraordinary women who transcend usual limitations of gender roles that hardly makes the whole society matriarchal." End quote. And feminists themselves reject these warrior women as somehow a testament to female equality, because these women, in order to be recognized, had to display masculine attributes. This shows that what was valued in this culture were masculine attributes, which is going to be a patriarchy, because men are going to have these attributes far more than women. Okay, so we've covered the three pillars of Western civilization, and we've come up short. Gender equality, equality of women, cannot be found in Greek or Romans, it cannot be found in the Catholic Church of the Middle Ages, and it cannot be found in the Germanic tribes. So where did it come from? Well, the answer is it started during the Enlightenment, and then it kind of grew and festered into something that I'll get into a little bit later. But let's talk about the Enlightenment first. According to my source, quote, "The philosophers of the age believed that you ought to be able to use your intelligence to reconstruct your society. If science could progress as it was during that era, so could humans. And women took that to mean it included them too. Enlightenment thinkers had a high regard for knowledge, so the idea of equality between women and men, particularly in regards to education, became an important issue for women. While some philosophers purported the emancipation of women, some of the greatest thinkers of the Enlightenment, while defending the democratic principles of equality, believed that these principles should only be applied to their own gender and their own race. The idea of enlightened reason excluded women because of what was seen by many as their innate feminine characteristics, which were viewed as inferior, weak, and childlike." Now, there were exceptions. Let me talk about the exceptions. So the first exception, John Locke. John Locke's theory of the mind was that it was a blank slate, or a tabula rasa. He maintained that we are born without innate ideas, as all knowledge is acquired. He seemed quite egalitarian concerning the education of boys and girls. In the idea that man was superior to woman was an idea invented by men, it was therefore reversible. Unfortunately, he said, subordination was apparently a woman's lot, but not her destiny. He thought women should be on equal footing with men within a marriage and argued the biblical Adam did not have private dominion over the world, but shared it with Eve. Philosophers such as Thomas Hobbes and Jeremy Bentham both advocated equal rights for women. Hobbes attacked the theory of the natural male superiority over women, arguing that there was no rational justification for it. Bentham spoke for complete equality between the sexes, including the right to vote and to participate in government, and he opposed the strongly different sexual moral standard for men and women. Mary Wollstonecraft is arguably one of the most influential of women thinkers in history, and a pioneer in the age of female repression. In 1792, she wrote her Vindication of the Rights of Women, one of the earliest works of feminist philosophy. In it, she established a solid case in support for emancipation. She challenged the perception by men that women were by nature inferior, weak, and childlike, and proposed many social and political changes, ranging from education to civil and political rights, and women's rights to be elected political representatives. In the 19th century, Frederick Engels would describe marriage as a state where the husband is the bourgeoisie and the wife is the proletariat. Wollstonecraft described marriage as legalized prostitution. When the Declaration of the Rights of Man was read, Olympe de Gouges, a French playwright and political activist, wrote her famous Declaration of the Rights of Woman and the Female Citizen. She took point by point of the Declaration of the Rights of Man and declared that it was a revolution which had been devoted to men only. De Gaulle dedicated her declaration to Marie Antoinette, who she despised, and declared, "If under French law women have the right to die on the guillotine, they must also have the right to mount the speaker's rostrum." She herself died on the guillotine during the Reign of Terror. To summarize, it is often said that women gained nothing from the Enlightenment. In some ways, the position of women was seriously degraded. Women had truly thought that the American and French revolutions would bring in a general social transformation. It didn't happen then. But the seed for gender equality had been planted, and an increasing number of women began to agitate for human rights for women too. Progress was painfully slow. There would be other more pressing social and economic changes to be fought for in the next century and a half, and the structure of society would have to change before the women's question would be addressed again. So we can see that during the Enlightenment, there were some philosophers that entertained the idea of giving women rights, such as the right to vote, the right to be educated, so on and so forth. However, the source alludes to a change in the structure of society that would have to happen before the women's question would be addressed again. And now let's go to the heart. What is this change in society which really rose the women question to the fore? I'm just going to read from the source. It says, quote, "Marx and Engels offered scathing, polemical criticisms of the bourgeoisie family and the exploitation of women in the Communist Manifesto. The bourgeoisie has not even a suspicion that the real point aimed at is to do away with the status of women as mere instruments of production. However, the critiques displays little insight into the ways that gender relations and the social institutions of the family affect the life situations of women. And it fails to identify the structural ways in which women were denied access to political positions, economic opportunity, or basic components of health assurance. Friedrich Engels devoted more extensive attention to issues surrounding sex, gender, and the family in his anthropological book, The Origins of the Family, Private Property and the State. Based largely on the work of early ethnographer Lewis Henry Morgan, Engels argues that there is a great historical variety in the sexual and reproductive practices of primates and human groups. And he offers a historical hypothesis for the emergence of a paired couple family, the emergence of private property and slavery. Socialist and communist theorists of the decades between the death of Marx and the First World War gave specific prominence to issues of women's equality. Lenin gave attention to the problem of sexual inequality in bourgeoisie society in his journalism and the widely read interview with the German feminist Clara Zetkin. Other leading communist thinkers of the decades between 1880 and 1920 also placed issues of female emancipation and women's equality at the center of their socialist agenda. For example, Rosa Luxemburg, Nikolai Bokharam, Clara Zetkin, Leon Trotsky, and Alexandra Kollontai. These developments had important consequences for the policy priorities for communist governments once they seized power in Russia, China, and Cuba. Socialist and communist ideas thus had a large effect on progress towards greater gender equality in the 20th century. For a mix of reasons, both ideological and political, women leaders and the issue of the equal treatment of women have been substantial influence on policy and outcomes in the Soviet Union, Eastern Europe, China, and Cuba. This progress has occurred in multiple spheres, in the area of legal and constitutional declarations of equality of treatment, in the transformation of some of the basic institutions governing family, marriage, and child rearing, and in the successful provisioning of basic social goods, education, healthcare, access to economic opportunities, in a way that has become closer to establishing equality of outcomes for men and women. End quote. Okay, so I just read a lot of stuff, and thank you for bearing with me. The concept of gender equality started as a thought experiment, a hypothetical, during the Enlightenment, but it metastasized into Marxism. Now, you can claim that feminism and Marxism is somehow the central pillar of Western civilization, but you're full of shit. Marxism is not, has not, and never has been a central value of Western civilization. You're talking about 100 years of unmitigated failure from an idea that didn't even work on paper. This is not a value of Western civilization. I also find it endlessly entertaining that so-called anti-feminists, they claim to be against third-wave feminism, but yet they advocate all the central tenets of feminism. You were exactly like these Bolsheviks and these communists in the early 1900s, where before it was tried, everybody thought this was a great idea, we should do it. And then when it failed, you're like, well, that wasn't real communism. Communism always fails, it's always going to fail, it's never going to succeed because it goes against human nature, period. This is why it always fails. And these people are like, well, that wasn't real communism. We need to try it again, and this time it's going to work because this is real communism. You claim that third wave feminism isn't real feminism, or your version of egalitarianism is real feminism, you're full of shit. You're just like these communists who don't want to admit your ideology doesn't work. The whole belief in the Enlightenment was based on the tabula rasa blank slate theory, which has been scientifically disproven. It is from that tabula rasa theory where we get the whole concept of gender being a social construct, that if you raise a boy as a girl and you raise a girl as a boy, they'll be just as good as the other. It's not true. It's provably not true. I understand a communist in the early 1900s, before communism was tried, when all they heard were the good things, all the promises of communism, I can almost excuse them for going along with it because it sounds great. The promises of communism sound wonderful, but the problem is communism doesn't work. And it's not the 1900s anymore, it's 2017. People need to stop advocating for fucking communism. Now, likewise, you so-called anti-feminists, you're just like these communists who say that's not real communism. Third wave feminism isn't real egalitarianism. Intersectional feminism isn't real egalitarianism. My egalitarianism is great. You just have to implement it right. No, it doesn't fucking work. gender isn't a social construct. Men and women are different biologically, mentally, physically, emotionally. So you can continue to fight for real feminism, because that feminism wasn't real feminism, and it's going to totally work this time. Or you could admit it doesn't work. You can stop trying to make communism work, admit it doesn't work, and go back to what does work. Anyway, this is Turd Flinging Monkey. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.